Okay, if we can open this meeting of the ninth meeting of the Public Petitions Committee in this session, and can I remind members and others in the room to switch phones and other devices to silent. Our first agenda item this morning is a consideration of continued petitions, and the first one of these is petition 1319 in improving youth football in Scotland. The first item on the agenda today is petition 1319 on improving youth football in Scotland. The petition called for action on 6 points, 4 of which have been addressed in previous years. The issues that remain to be considered are contracts and compensation payments between clubs. There are a number of actions that have been suggested in these issues and associated questions about welfare and the rights of the children and young people involved. We shall be taking evidence in the petitions from two panels. The first panel comprises representatives of PFA Scotland, the Scottish Schools Football Association and the Scottish Youth Football Association. The second panel we'll hear from is the Scottish Football Association and the Scottish Professional Football League. We'll also hear a future meeting from the Children and Young People's Commissioner for Scotland, who was unable to be with us today for personal reasons. And can I welcome James Dornan, MSP, and Richard Leonard, MSP, who are in attendance and will be participating in this particular agenda item. I understand that Scott Robertson and Willie Smith are also attending today, and they are obviously the petitioners and have driven this from the beginning. I'd like to make the most of the time we have available this morning by going straight into questions. We do have copies of written submissions from each of the witnesses, so we have a fair steer from that to where we are at the meeting. So to our first panel, may I welcome to our meeting Fraser Wishart of PFA Scotland, Roderick Houston of the Scottish Schools Football Association and David Little of the Scottish Youth Football Association. This is obviously very interesting issue and in some ways very complex, and I think for our new committee we want to try and get a proper understanding of the issues of concern. I just want to start off with a very simple question around the issue of welfare considerations. So I'd like to begin with the issue of players registered under the Club Academy Scotland system being able to play for their schools and the response from the SFA SPPFL that a rule change would be made to reflect that there should be no restrictions on this, quote, subject to appropriate welfare concerns. And I wonder if I can ask you to express your views on this issue of appropriate welfare concerns.
Thank you and good morning. We welcomed that move on behalf of the Scottish FA. We are strongly committed to youngsters playing for their school wherever possible. There had been a long and fairly potted history of this relationship following an embargo on the elite boys playing for their school and girls. We think there has been significant progress in the last year. We still are receiving anecdotal evidence which gives us cause for one specific concern, and that is that quite often young players are put in the position of having to make a choice between school and maybe a club or what have you. We would prefer there to be a dialogue between the adults with the young person involved to allow it. There is no question there has to be a kind of negotiated is too strong a word, but an agreed programme of demand on the young person in all sorts of ways, and we're quite happy to be party to that, and we can find around the country a lot of very good examples of just that. But the anecdotal evidence is still there that some young people are put in a terrible position, which we are uncomfortable with.
Does that mean that the appropriate welfare concerns could simply be the club saying, well, it doesn't suit us for you to play for your team, we need you? And so that's a kind of a relationship which is a difficult one for a young person to negotiate.
Sorry, appropriate welfare concerns is quite a nebulous statement. And, you know, what one person might deem... Sorry?
It's not in your interest to do this.
Well, I don't like that. I would like the child to be able to be involved, preferably the parents as well, to say, well, this allows our youngster to play with his pals. And for the pals, that's great. And for the youngster, it gets them suitably involved with their peer group. And there has been evidence of a distancing of the very elite kids from their peer group in school. Not much, not too nasty, but not really what we want to happen in the communities that are in schools.
Thanks very much for that. I don't know if other members of the panel want to comment on that. It's all right. It'll come on its own.
Yeah. It's not particularly an area. Sorry, good morning, and thank you for the invite to inform this process. It's not really an area where we are experts in it, but I think the changes that have been made on the surface should be welcomed. I think, as Rod said there, for a young person to be able to play football with their friends is, for me, one of the most important things about development. When they go into the Club Academy Scotland and it's elite, there are players coming from all over the area, sometimes all over the country for training. But just playing with your friends in the local area, playing with your schoolmates, I think is very important. And also, even just from a developmental perspective, the more football that people can play, the better. I think children nowadays don't play football the way that I did 30, 40 years ago, where you're playing constantly. You just get a ball when you get home when you're out in the streets. So we always talk about 10,000 hours elite development as to the level of how many hours you should get as a young person. So this all adds to it. What it means in practice, I don't think any of us know at the moment. Rod certainly would know more than I do in terms of, you said, appropriate welfare concerns. And I think the reality of it all will come out, whether players who are signed with Club Academy Scotland teams are actually playing for the schools. I think that will come out in the wash at some point. But I think it was a step forward taken by the SFA and the SPFL.
It may be something we want to monitor in terms of the figures for that. It'd be something useful to know. Angus MacDonald.
Okay, thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. If I could turn to the 28-day period. As we know, the new measures include enabling a player to give 28 days' notice, after which they could return to the recreational game. However, some submissions comment on the need for clarity about the conditions for the return of a player in these circumstances to the academy system. So can I ask your views on the conditions that they should apply in such circumstances?
Good morning, and thank you for allowing the Scottish Youth FA to be represented today. In respect of the 28-day rule, this was a rule that was put in place in May 1999 when the Scottish Youth FA was formed, and it was to eliminate the unscrupulous among the grassroots game that at that particular time would say, no, we're going to hold on to a player for the full season. Since then, at our last AGM in June this year, we have taken the 28 days away, as I've indicated in my written submission, and we allow for a period of 7 days. We will always err on the side of the child. The only reason that we have the 7 days is if there's a dispute between a club and a player, the player writes to me as chief executive. We ask for comments from the club. If the club don't reply within the 7-day timescale, we automatically cancel the player's registration. The only kind of two reasons that we would seek further clarification is that if the player owes the club kit, or if there's any items surrounding finance that have still to be resolved. Apart from that, we would cancel the player straight away.
Just for interest, do you have a percentage of the number of clubs that do respond within 7 days?
It's not something that we measure. However, what I would say is, and don't hold me to this being exact, but 99.99% of players seeking release, and we roughly cancel about 15,000 players per year. Of the ones in dispute, we probably have maybe about 15 per year. The interesting thing earlier on, I alluded to, financial matters. One of the situations that we had to deal with was a club who had a young player. He'd been at the club for 2 years. The club were alluding to the fact that he owed them his fees for 2 years. At that particular time, And I'll brush up my reply, but it was basically go away. The guy has been with you for 2 years, and now because he wishes to leave, you want to retain his registration. So that registration was cancelled.
Thank you.
Thank you, Brian Tuttle.
Thank you. Welcome to the panel. Turning to the issue of compensation, the Scottish Schools Football Association has commented that with reimbursement of costs remaining, there are a number of risks. These include a child being regarded as a commodity, the implication, of course, being the child is owned by the club, and the risk of such payments being used as leverage. If we look at if we are agreement that the welfare of the child and the enjoyment of the child in sport is paramount, especially to the longevity in the sport, is this a risk that is recognised and shared by the panel?
I perhaps can initially respond. It's a risk that we've highlighted. It's a risk that we've been unable thus far to delineate. But we have, again, a lot of anecdotal evidence of very unhappy kids. And where compensation becomes an issue, there are cases where children simply walk away from the game. This can't be good for the game or necessarily for the child or the child's relationship with his or her peer group in school and in the community. Just the whole notion of transactions around young players gives rise to concerns. The general notion gives rise to concerns on the part of the Scottish Schools FA. We have commented frequently over the last 10 years or so on this, and we continue to hold those concerns. We haven't been mollified in any way whatsoever. I struggle at times to understand why clubs don't see that they're benefiting the game and benefiting themselves. Maybe it's coming from a school's football background. We get kids to play football. That's what we're interested in doing. And if a school does well and they get some good experiences, you know, who would have said that Stranraer Academy going to Stornoway en route to getting to a final in Hampden wasn't a great experience for the kids? You know, they'll tell you it was an epic journey, it was the whole thing. These are good things. But the minute they become commodities, the minute there's compensation, you're detracting from these possibilities. You're preventing kids from getting there. And we're concerned about the overall welfare of children. And if these things are getting in the way, it shouldn't happen in our view.
Can I just follow in? I mean, what's your interaction been then with the academies and the SFA and clubs and discussion around this?
Continual dialogue between our SFA representative and the higher echelons of the SFA through the committees, and at local level between local people on the association's executive committee and senior people at clubs. And if we find an impasse, we try to help. Can I just point you to one of the points we made in the paper, where when you have these issues and a commodity, the school's not represented when they meet. And I'm thinking to myself, who's there as a kind of third party to make sure of the overall benefit? If you've got a child with a problem relating to social work, family circumstances, all those things, the school has a chance to offer a view to assist in finding the best outcome for the child. If the impasse is they can't move from one club to the other because of a fee, the school needs to be involved to help that child through it. And we would strongly urge the committee to consider representation for the school where we have these cases to deal with.
Are you suggesting, therefore, that in these circumstances, not that I want to put any words in your mouth, of course, that it's these circumstances are weighed against the child?
Not necessarily, but there is a risk of it, and that risk is something we should seek to avoid if we can, or diminish.
Okay, thank you.
Could I comment on that? I think we've got to be very careful when compensation comes into play. We've got to look at this as being child-centric, and we've got to look at it from their position. In the recreational game, schools, youth, amateurs, welfare, etc., our main function, our core business, is getting people to play and enjoy the game. So the compensation issue shouldn't be a barrier to participation. I know at a previous hearing of the petition, there was a dispute between two of the major clubs, evidence from two of the major clubs that there was a bidding war that that was round about £30,000 for a player, and that's in your records. I think that needs to be eliminated, and that if there are guidelines, which there are now, those guidelines must be maximums. If it says within there that the compensation fee is £5,000, we shouldn't have an auction over over a child and allow it to get out of hand.
Before I take in, Rona, can I just maybe ask for the PFA from their own evidence, and you can respond to that point as well when you do so, that on the issue of the 28 days notice, it doesn't apply to young people, or it may not apply to young people who are moving to another club, as opposed to going back to recreation football. And also in your submission you say, as the current system stands, when a young player signs for a professional club under the Club Academy Scotland registration at, say, aged 11, he or she cannot join another professional club unless his current club allows him to until the age of 23, as long as the club exercises unilateral rights to retain his registration.
Yeah, I think that the issue of compensation is absolutely vital here. I understand completely in terms of the Club Academy Scotland players. The clubs have concerns, they have worries about the bigger clubs cherry-picking, about a loss of control, about players moving from club to club every year. I understand that, but I think their fears are ill-founded. We're just 21 years earlier this month since the Bosman ruling, which gave players freedom of movement. It's incredible it took so long to give them free movement when their contract finished, because even when your contract was finished, prior to that, there's still compensation payable. And Bosman was going to be a disaster for football. Now here we are 21 years later, the game is flourishing at most levels, certainly in a professional sense. So I think those fears are ill-founded. And I just come back to the fact that it's about the individual. And this is what we really should be talking about here, is the individual young person, young lad in these circumstances. And having just been through it with my own son through his teenage years, their bodies are changing, their minds are changing. If they are unhappy and they don't want to stay at a club, I don't think compensation should be a barrier to them moving to another professional club. 28 days allows them to go back to the SYFA under their jurisdiction. But from what I understand, when they come back, if say 2 years later they come back into the Club Academy Scotland, there'll still be compensation payable. And that's where the three-year registration kicks in, which we might get to. And when you reach the age of 16, when you sign a professional contract as a player, you're then bound by FIFA's regulations, which bring in compensation. So again, it's as long as they make you a certain offer of a certain amount of salary. So it is genuinely 11. If the club picks up your registration unilaterally at the end of every season and it carries on to your 23, then that's when you're actually free. And that to me is an issue. We've kind of got more involved in this area. We've watched the petition as it's developed, mainly because more and more parents are coming to us about the issues that surround their lad in the registration. More than they're asking for information, they don't seem to be, I'm generalising here, some clubs do, some clubs don't, give the proper information. And if you said to a parent, did you realise when your lad signed at 11 that was him, he couldn't leave, they'd probably say no. So I just think that compensation needs to be looked at. There must be an alternative way if there's a willingness there to have a compensation pool, perhaps separately, that the clubs can apply to under certain circumstances. I mean, a huge debate can be done, but any compensation shouldn't disallow a young person from deciding, I'm not happy at Club A, I'm not enjoying it, and I'm a 14-year-old boy, I want to go and play for Club B. That's the fundamental that I can't get my head around the sort of the compromising of the rights of children.
Thanks very much. Rona, can I?
Yes, thank you. Again, this is about compensation, but just for sort of clarity, are you saying that the requirement of having a system of compensation could be met through a mechanism other than the one currently in place? Is there an alternative suggestion? I think you said you think there should be. Would the suggestion that compensation should only be payable when a young player first signs a professional contract, is that compliant with FIFA regulations?
The second part, then, I'm not too sure of that. You ask the SFA and the SPFL of that and the FIFA regulations. But in a sense of, is there an alternative? Absolutely. I mean, there's a lot of people involved in football who are bright in professional football, and I think they've got around the table. We'd be able to come up with an alternative and there are plenty of ideas around. There could be a levy on transfers, there could be a separate pool, an independent panel, that when a player signed as a professional player at 16, they're off their professional contract, then the clubs that developed him could apply to the panel for compensation. So it's not just for every player, it's only for the ones that actually make it to the professional game. It should be actual costs as well, rather than the matrix that's put together by the Scottish FA, which in a sense, because the compensation levels are higher for the bigger clubs, means that players at bigger clubs are stuck there because smaller clubs will not pay compensation. So they can't decide, I'm at a big club, I'm not enjoying it, I'll go and play somewhere else. So absolutely, I think it's we couldn't do it in this hour, but there are ways and means if there's a willingness to provide a different type of compensation system and not while not restricting the movement of the young player.
That was my next question, was realistically, how easy do you think it will be to change the current system? Or, you know, it won't happen overnight, but, you know, can it be done, do you think, in the current setup?
It can be done if there's a willingness. Now, the clubs are the ones who control that side of it, so depending on the willingness of the clubs. I know there's a fear of cherry-picking and of movement of players, and a smaller club develops a young player and they put a lot of time and effort into it, and then he moves to a big club when he's 14, 15, and they've not done anything. I understand that. But there'd be a greater flow of players if there's no compensation, because the smaller clubs could then say to the bigger club, the player at a bigger club, come and play for us. There's a pathway to our first team. And at the moment, the pathway to most of the first teams is blocked. There's not enough young players coming through. So it's wider than just the compensation. This is about developing our players, about the national team's performance, our clubs in Europe. It's about the fact that we're looking for players from the lower leagues in England and Ireland as a short term. I understand, friends of mine manage football clubs, their jobs are on the line if they don't win the next three games. But if their club's got a better ethos where they can say to young lads, come and play for us because you're going to play in our first team, that's how you attract young players to stay at your club rather than going to a bigger club. So there is if there's a willingness, then there's a way. Whether that willingness is there, I don't know.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. This is a question about the registration period, panel. On the registration period for players in the 15 to 17-year-old age group, there are a couple of things I'd like to explore with the panel. The Commissioner for the Children and Young People has noted that this is an issue which causes most concern. We will be able to explore that with the Commissioner at a future meeting, but is that the view shared by others?
If I could perhaps start. We are concerned that for boys, predominantly 15 to 17 years of age, can be a time of considerable turmoil, internal issues, family issues, realisation that education actually counts. There are all sorts of things. And we think that's quite a long time for them to be tied. We would like to see sharper, you know, if it's going to be 3 years that the club has first refusal in the current system, then we'd like to see better cut-off points, more explicitly stated cut-off points, a more explicitly stated mechanism for dealing with it. Because in my experience with young players, that's from U15 to U18 is when we have to deal with an awful lot of stuff. That's not necessarily the football itself, but that. And to sort of say, right, there you go, that's you for 3 years. And you might find that the young player simply isn't enjoying it. So we've got to have, I think, more explicit arrangements to, if 3 years, and Fraser's right about the concerns of clubs, we would never fail to recognise their concern that they'll get lost elsewhere. Although the extent to which that happens remains to be measured more fully, I think. We would want there to be a clear pattern of points in that period where the youngster and his family, and we would argue the school, of course, take stock of it with the club, and the club needs to be perhaps a little more flexible in how it approaches it at times.
Thank you.
James Stoner.
Good morning. I want to talk about the three-year contract. Just correct me if I'm wrong here, but the three-year contract is one that holds the player to the club and means that they can hold them, but the player at that stage doesn't have the same right to see the three-year contract through. Would that be right? That the club can let them go after a year, but can hold them for three, but the player doesn't have a reciprocal arrangement with the club?
It's to do with when you reach the age of 15, if the club has a right, unilaterally retains the registration, then that gives them the right to do that every year after that. So although it can be for 3 years, it's only really for a year, but then it gives the club the right again to choose whether they retain you at the end of that year. The issues we have around that, it's more kind of from perhaps a trade union point of view, to do with employment as well, because at that stage of reaching the age of 16, that's you 1 year into the sort of 3 year registration period. There's no obligation on the club to offer any of these lads a professional contract, but they can hold on to the registration and keep them as amateur players, meaning that the lad can't go and play for another professional club, say he could get a contract to be an apprentice somewhere else. And I feel that restricts, so there could be work done there where, you know, the club was allowed to retain the registration at the age of 16 if they offer him a professional contract. Because again, I have sympathy with the clubs and the big English club circle, you know, that they've all got full-time scouts in Scotland, and they circle around, and I understand why the clubs want to make sure that they get compensation at that stage. But I can't, again, get my head around how you can keep a registration but stop somebody getting a job elsewhere, which essentially is what it is.
Could I just add one wee bit? Of course, the statutory school leaving age is right in the middle of that period. So you can have a situation where a child is leaving school but can't actually go and do something because they're not being offered a professional contract. So we think that the things out of kilter with other legislative frameworks as they apply to children.
I think the reality of it is that when you've got a group of 20 players at under 16 level and clubs have got to choose, and restricted budgets, you know, they can't afford to take everybody on. So talent identification, if they take on three or four, they might have three or four that they think they're still decent players, but we can't afford to take them on. So they'll retain them as amateurs, but they'll give three or four of the apprentice contracts. Again, you can sympathise with that element where they're not wanting to lose that control of them. But again, it comes back to not being able to be offered a job.
Sorry, David, but surely you can only sympathise with it to the extent that if you're looking at it from a strictly business point of view, but you can't sympathise with it if what you're looking for is the benefit of the child, you know, to make sure that people stay involved in the game and just common decency and fairness, because it sounds to me that all the cards are in the hands of the club and none of them in the hands of the child. And having been a father of two teenage sons, having run amateur and junior football clubs, I know that at that period, kids sign things and their parents are sort of forced into it. I was one myself at some stage. When the glamour of it takes over from the common sense of it, and it's a very, very difficult thing to do. So it's a very important issue. Sorry, David.
It is that around 100 young lads got apprenticeship contracts in the summer, prior summer, this summer of 2016. And out of the previous tranche, it's usually a two-year apprenticeship programme they go into that's funded by SDS. And the lads who came in 2 years ago and who turned 18, whose initial two-year contract finished, about 35 got further contracts. Now, if you think of the number of players that have come through that age group from the age 11, if you counted them all, I'd be guessing as to how many would actually be have actually been registered during that whole period. But over a seven-year period, for only 35 to get contracts at the end of it, I just think that should be known. That should be told. We have to get the truth out there that football is a fantastic life. I mean, I've been involved in football for all my working life. Very lucky as a player and administrator, but it's hard. And it's hard, and it's about, as you said, the welfare of the child, the interests of the child. It's the school's talking about school leaving age and education, and it's about how we get into the minds of young people that the chances are they're not going to make it without taking away that dream. That's that we don't want to take away. But all these barriers are put in place, and the truth of it is, say only 35 people got pro contracts at age 18 this year at the full-time clubs.
Can I just say that this particular age group is one of the most vulnerable age groups within Scottish society, and we need to take as many steps as possible to support them. I welcome the reports in the press about Operation Brave, which is basically to reduce the amount of players within Club Academy Scotland. My contribution to Scottish football was coining the term jersey filler, and there's too many jersey fillers within the system, and we shouldn't give players, young players, expectations. A friend at the English FA did some research on this, and that they reckon 0.17% of players through academy systems actually go on to get full professional contracts. If we take that 0.17% and in a Scottish context call it 100%, You then have to ask the secondary question, how many of that actually make a living out of playing football? I think in respect of the three-year age group, players should have the choice. And if there are programmes that are better, and I think that's the way of retaining players, have the best possible programme. But I also think, and again from a previous submission, a RIA survey that was carried out, it basically said that 55% of people surveyed commented that their club explained registration to them. Now, with my O-level in arithmetic, that means 45% didn't explain. So I think we've got to have robust guidelines for players, because players are trying to latch on to a star. They're trying to latch on to a journey. And sometimes parents wish to travel in the same journey. So I think there needs to be robust paperwork, and there needs to be a sign-off in that paperwork that it has actually taken place, and that both the player and the parents accept and understand that. So any documentation has got to be child-centric.
Point. Thank you, Convener. I think that's a very good point, but would you also say that in that process it would have to be something that showed, without killing the dream, that the likelihood of you making a living out of football is much less than you think it is when you sign that document? Because most of them sign it because they think they're going to play for Scotland as centre-forward or something. But the reality is that you're going to end up playing amateur football, you're going to end up playing junior football, and you want to keep that, you want to keep the dream alive, but you also want to make sure that they're realistic, so that when they end up having to go, their bubble isn't burst and you're losing to football. And I know many young men that have stopped playing because of that.
I think we've also got to accept that during this period, bodies are changing. The player that maybe wasn't the diamond at 14s may become the diamond at 17s. So I think we've got to look at that. It's a bit like one of the things that happened within your constituency when we had the X Factor additions at Hampden. I know. That was because you were the one with the dog. But can I say in that respect, again, thousands of kids turning up, and I think there's people far more qualified than me within the Scottish Football Association, and also my learned friend to my left, that need to put something together and explain and have clear, unequivocal facts out there about chances. Not wishing to kill the dream, but having to deal with the consequences.
Thank you.
Two points, if I may just... Oh, come in. Sorry, Chair. May I come in? Thank you. 2 points. One, there is a risk with this system that late developers overlook because they're abandoned at 15. And I would suggest that you might want to look at what happens in Belgium. They have a wonderful late developers programme, and a significant proportion of their national team, which is one of the better national teams around just now, come from that. With the notion of the dream and reality, it's a difficult balance. It's one we deal with in all sorts of contexts in schools. They need the dream to motivate them, so we can't lose sight of the dream, but we have to kind of cushion it with, well, let's have some insurance, you know, just in case. I've got a good example of a young lad who's currently playing full-time in professional football in Scotland. He comes from the far north, who had a late development physically, then had developmental issues in his skeleton. I basically had to take a year out of the game. People thought the game had forgotten him. He still had the dream and the determination, and he's now in the game and at one of the largest clubs in this country. So we have to kind of find a balance. But at the same time he was out, he continued with some education just to cover it. And I think it's finding the appropriate balance again.
Richard Lent.
Thanks for allowing me to join the committee this morning. And my brief includes fair work. So I was particularly struck by the PFA Scotland's submission, which spoke about something we haven't got to yet, which is the national minimum wage. And you say in the submission, Mr. Wishart, that some of the clubs are paying as little as £1 a week, when we know that the national minimum wage, even for 16 to 18-year-olds, is £4 an hour. I wonder whether you could elaborate a bit more about your experience of pay rates and some of the reasons that lie behind those kind of rates being paid.
Yeah, I mean, unfortunately, I have seen contracts recently as well of £1 a week and £10 a week, and this goes all the way down to the part-time clubs as well. I think we all say that's unacceptable. The law applies to everybody, and sometimes clubs will say, yeah, but the player agreed to it. And you think, well, no, an employee and employer are not allowed to contract out of the national minimum wage standards. And I would like to see something in the rules to address that. I mean, HMRC on its website says that a contract is invalid if it doesn't pay the national minimum wage, which to me creates all the problems for football in terms of registration and compensation and eligibility to play. Players are reluctant to raise complaints sometimes, especially when they're younger lads, because if you raise a complaint, the reality is that you might not play, you might not get a new contract, so they kind of go along with it. There was a situation a couple of years ago, I think, when I think it was in front of this committee, a young lad, Kieran Doran's case was brought forward, and Skills Development Scotland, as a funder for the apprenticeship programme, wrote to all the clubs just to make sure they were paying the minimum wage via the training company. I think one or two did have to change their wage. The difficulty, of course, is what does a football player do? What is their working week? But that's something I think that could be agreed with by ourselves as a union and the clubs. So therefore, you have a starting point, because players, for example, are not allowed to go out on a Thursday or Friday night. You know, not socially, stay out of pubs, restaurants, wherever else, rest. Now, if they don't and they get caught going out for a sneaky pint somewhere, then they can be sanctioned, they can be punished. So therefore, and from my point of view, that's them working. So it's an issue I think that could and should be dealt with, but we're told there's no appetite really from the clubs to deal with that in terms of regulation. Of course, the players can come forward and go to HMRC, which one or two of them are doing. They can go to the SPFL with a complaint as well. But I say they're reluctant to do so sometimes. And one club recently we went out to, and it was young lads who were 17, 18, not in the apprenticeship programme, and they weren't getting paid the minimum wage. And I sat around at the table with the club, just trying to negotiate, trying to talk through it, and their reaction was to actually shorten their hours, you know, rather than actually pay them the minimum wage. So full-time footballers now are in for 16 hours a week. And how they can develop as a professional footballer on that basis, I don't know. Rather than looking at it, in most jobs, if you're 17, you reach 18, you know you're going to get a wage rise. You know, minimum wage is going to be put up. But in football, it seems to be it's real the other way.
Thanks, that's very helpful. But I wonder if I could move on, just because I know time's limited, to something else that we haven't discussed, which I think is important. We've spoken about clubs, the lads themselves, parents. But there is also now in the game a set of people who are agents and intermediaries. And I wonder whether you could perhaps tell the committee a bit more about their role in the way that this registration scheme works.
Absolutely. I mean, this is absolutely relevant to the petition and the welfare of young people and children. It's a concern for us. As a short history, FIFA used to have a licensing system where you had to pass an exam. And you then had to sort of post indemnity insurance or a bond of some kind, and that there were checks and regulations. FIFA disbanded that completely for reasons only known to themselves, I think mainly because most transfers weren't being conducted by licensed agents. And what they did was they gave a minimum set of standards to every association in our situation, like the Scottish FA, and that was the minimum amount, and they are pretty minimal, and they allowed the countries to create their own regulations on top of that. We've had concerns, which we have raised with the SFA and the clubs, and they're aware of our concerns. In this area, the concerns are lack of really disclosure and PVG checks, I think, for those who register as intermediaries, as they're now called. They are allowed to sign representation contracts of sorts with with minors. So an 11, 12-year-old lad with a guardian's approval can sign a contract for an intermediary to represent him at that age. Why you need somebody to represent you at that age, I don't know. An agent's really there to conduct the negotiations for a contract of employment. So these are areas that do concern us. There are no limits to the length of that representation contract, although the one caveat that has been put in at our request was the 3-month notice period until you're 18. But you can sign a representation contract for 20 years. If you don't implement the notice period, by the time you're 18, that's you're stuck with this intermediary representing you. So I think in terms of the welfare of young people, I think there should be greater checks of any intermediary that's going to interact with young people. I actually think they shouldn't be allowed to sign a representation contract with a person under 16. That is my view. You do not need representation. You do not need an agent until you are 16. But if they're going to have it, then I think there should be greater checks put in place.
Could I make just one point on that? And it's maybe homework for the panel. There is a book, The Secret Agent, Inside the World of the Football Agent, that's worthy of reading. The author, surprise, surprise, is anonymous.
Yep. Sorry, but can I just confirm that you've said that these intermediaries don't go through Disclosure Scotland?
Darley. I mean, the SFA will have a checking system, and I'm sure they can explain it a bit more clearly. But if it doesn't stand out, there's not any requirement for disclosure.
Wow.
Thank you. The three panel members here are all here because they have the role makes them feel responsible for the welfare of the school children, the young players, the players in general. Do you not think that what seems to be coming out of the evidence here is that there seems to be an almost total disregard for the welfare of the children coming from the authorities? Because, I mean, if you have agents that can interact with kids at 12 years of age that haven't been PVG checked, if you have contracts of £1 a week, and if you have, you know, you have no certainty around what that child is going to be able to do when it reaches 16, 17 and 18, that's surely a dereliction of duty on those that should be looking after these children. Because I'm convener of the Education Skills Committee, child protection is in our remit, and I'm kind of horrified by some of the stuff that I'm hearing here today.
I think just to come in on that, the school's FA is profoundly concerned about this development, and it's in recent years, really. And we think one of the reasons is that parents feel intimidated by clubs, and they think that an agent will know how to stand up to a club. So I think we've got to balance it that way. We're profoundly concerned about intermediaries. We think it's for anything up to school leaving age, it's completely inappropriate, and would ask that the game looks at that very seriously, particularly in the current environment, where we're at just at the minute.
Thank you. I'm just clarifying this question of the minimum wage. My understanding is that clubs have either sought or been given advice on how to avoid the minimum wage. Do you have a view on the ethics of even seeking that advice?
Well, when we've been involved in speaking to clubs about the minimum wage and about other industrial issues, if you like, and I believe some of them sought advice from the SPFL centrally, and I understand their lawyers put together a document. I don't think it was to avoid paying it, but there were suggestions around 0 hours contracts and other matters as well, as a way of clubs being able to budget for these matters. I mean, you would be no great surprise that we disagreed with a lot of the impact in that, and I think these things are not possible in football anyway.
There's not a lot of advantages in 0 hours contracts, but at least you're allowed to say I'm not going to go to my work. And it doesn't feel that in the clubs that you're describing that somebody can get paid £1 a week, £1 a month, but they're not able to go and take another job because they're expected to be at their work. And at one level, I mean, it's not so much to me the idea of the dream, I get that, but it's using the notion of that to encourage young people to work against their own interests. Because I can't see how it can possibly be anything other than, I mean, I don't know if you agree with me, that it's simple exploitation to work on the basis that somebody would do this because they have some ambition to go and work for little or no money, exclude the possibility of working elsewhere, and not really have any control over their own destiny?
In my experience, it tends to be around, again, compensation. One lad who was on a £10 a week contract was the only one of the under 20s. It was a part-time club, and the only one of the under 20s who wasn't on an amateur form. He was put into professional form, £10 a week, basically because the club were open about it. They lost a player who was actually turned out to be a decent player and made a career out of it, and they didn't get compensation because they only had him on an amateur form. So that tends to be why these players are put on these types of contracts. So it's just around retaining the right to compensation rather than players going free.
Mm. Okay, thanks very much. I'll take Brian and then Morris.
Can I just say, having been involved in sport for about 40 years and the last 20 years as a coach, having coached at national level, under 15, under 17, under 20 and senior level, I find it absolutely absurd that we are using words like agents and wages and compensation for kids who should be out playing the game and enjoying the game and falling in love with the game. I just don't understand how this current system in any way, shape or form looks after the welfare of the child. And what I would like to ask you is, from your position, what influence can you have on this system at the moment? Because I just think it's absolute. I'm getting so angry. I think it's insane.
I think anger is understandable, but we need to moderate it to actually find a way to solve the problem. I go back to something I said very early in our proceedings this morning about how we continue to have grave reservations about compensation culture, and we're seeing it here. I think a lot of these issues reflect that and would sustain the view we carry that needs to be looked at in a much... in a manner that is much more in keeping with the interests of the youngster. I mean, I think Fraser's last point about a club putting a kid on minimum kind of amount of money just to hold it is just a beggar's description. The beauty about it is, of course, in schools, we don't have these issues. Now, that's not being complacent or blasé, because we deal with the consequences of it with young children. You know, a kid comes back to school and says, I started pre-season and I hated it, but they'll not let me go. Right, come back into school, you can play school's football, we'll get you back in love with the game. Because one of the things that's getting lost in all this is winning people to the game. And I would make a plea to the committee to consider the welfare issues with that. And it's not only players. It's great for the best players and they perhaps become members of the Scottish PFA and, you know, good. It's about all the levels of the game. It's about people who become coaches, administrators, referees. You know, all these people count and they all go through school. And that's why we take a view on these things. That's why we're worried about the compensation culture. It's losing people to the game. And there is a question about the ethical approach.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Following on external regulation and following on from my previous comment, in his submission, the Children and Young Persons Commissioner set out his view that his overall impression is that the SFA and the SPFL have gone as far as they are prepared to go or are able to do so within their governing structures, and that for real change to occur, external regulation has to be imposed. Could I ask you as a panel what your thoughts are on this view?
I would hope that the family of football could come together. I can identify the issues that have been raised today, to identify the issues that have been raised on all the hearings of the petition, and that we can come with player-centric, and we can come up with rules and regulations that will enable the game to be much better regulated. I would hope that could take place.
Yeah, I think I agree. Football has got enough good people around, enough clever people around to get together to come up with a compensation system, if it has to be, or it's a registration system, a developmental system that's fair to the young person. I just... Take it, strip it all back, and we're all talking, and lawyers will talk, and it comes back to the young person. It comes back to I'm placing myself as a father. My son wasn't good enough to get to that level, but he played boys' club football and still does. how would I feel if I was that parent, if my young person was unhappy and was tied in? I can't get my head around the young person not having the opportunity to have that option to move around and to choose where they play. And see, the fallout rate is huge, and I think we're seeing it more and more, and the two gentlemen to either side will know more than I do about this. Certainly anecdotally, I hear more and more of lads when they leave a club academy system, they don't get a professional contract at 16, just stopping playing. Now, that's totally wrong. Some of my closest friends are people who I played with when I was playing in boys club football, aged 12, 13, 14, up to 16. Still very close to them, and it's a social thing. And if they don't make it at a certain level, find your level, play football. If that's amateur football, then absolutely fine. If that's five-a-side football, absolutely fine. There's fitness, there's health, there's all sorts of other benefits. There's social benefits, training two nights a week and playing a weekend as well, friendship aspect of it as well. And that to me is also very, very important. It's wider than just the game here. I think everybody has to look at it, solely from the individual's point of view.
I was going to ask what the extent to which in these conversations you've been engaged with the Scottish Government in terms of if the clubs aren't able to regulate themselves. I think the phrase was extensive discussions with the Scottish Government around what the options might be.
I know the word extensive was used, but I wouldn't have called it extensive. We do have good contacts. David Hamilton, who's the head, the sort of lead of strategic leader, I think his title is, and I found to be very good, very approachable, and speaks to everybody within football, which is certainly welcome from our point of view at PFA Scotland, because we do get frustrated sometimes. Extensive discussions, maybe exaggerating it slightly, but we have had discussions. See, this is not an area where we've been too involved in previously, but I think now, given the intermediaries, given it's a moral issue for us as an association as well, the developmental issues around the players, are we developing young footballers, and also the number of parents that are coming forward to us looking for advice, that's why we've kind of stepped into this area. So the contact's been welcome from government.
Okay, James Stoner.
I was just going to...
Oh, I apologise, sir.
No.
I've stopped you already.
I have a preference for Jaw rather than War. I think if everybody in football sat down and we actually started saying, right, here's the context we want a young person to be in, and Gerfek sits out there, it seems to me to still be current enough and applicable enough that we use that as a starting point. What happens at the minute is the interest of the clubs tends to be the starting point, and that's understandable in many senses, and bear in mind the clubs form the Scottish FA. So you have to find a way of that. I share Fraser's view. I think there's enough ability in the game to do these things. And I would just point out, the game needs to make the most of these abilities, which is why paragraph 2 of our response applies to my point here.
Thank you. It's kind of leading on from what you said, Convener. You're right, obviously, the ideal solution is an internal football one. Everybody's on the same page. But football has to accept that it doesn't stand alone. It's not an island, it's part of the community. And there doesn't seem to me to be a recognition of that, given the evidence that we've had today, that they have got a responsibility to those people that are involved in it. Not the three witnesses that we have here, but the general bodies. So how can you see that football in itself is going to do it unless they're willing to take that responsibility on?
It's always possible if parties to a discussion are prepared to accept change. If they start from a point of resistance. Part of my working life was involved in the Highland Football Academy Trust, which involved two professional football clubs, Inverness Caledonian and Thistle and Ross County. Now, if Club A thinks Club B is getting a scintilla of advantage, all hell breaks loose. Excuse the language, but it's appropriate. Right? You sit them down. We did proximity talks. ACAS style, and they eventually agreed. The Trust is a success. It is developing players. The two clubs are in the top division in Scotland, built on the foundations that they've built, because they realised that working together was much more important than running parallel paths. I see a direct link between that kind of discussion and the kind of discussions we need to have to address the sort of issues that members are raising this morning.
I think it's vitally important that all parties, all levels of the game need to become involved in this debate. certainly over the last few months, I've spoken to David Hamilton on a number of occasions. I found him to be very helpful, very informative, and I would have absolutely no difficulty going back and speaking to David on any issue.
Thank you so much. Brian, just a final last question.
As you've alluded to, there are some really good people in football from the SFA down who I'm quite sure would hold the same view as most of the people currently in this room, which begs the question, you know, why haven't they got round the table? And my concern would be, is this because of the power of the clubs? Is it the club voting system? Do they have too much control over what might change or what might not change?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, you're absolutely right in the sense that it's the clubs that are members of the SPFL. You know, that's they make the decisions. They are also member clubs and wider. There's more than just the 42. They're members of the SFA. And I think you're right that there's an intellectual argument to be won here about this whole issue. And I think it comes down, its fundamentals comes down to the clubs are scared to lose that diamond. They're scared to lose that one star player. And that's the wrong way to look at it, because that just leads to a complete inertia in terms of the movement of players, the flow of players. It's about taking away that fear and saying to a smaller club, even if at age 13 a bigger club comes and takes him, you've still got the ability to go and convince young people to come and play for your club, and that might be at one of our bigger clubs as well, which can't happen now because of the compensation system. So taking away that fear that they have and looking at the wider and greater good, our national team has been struggling for many years, our clubs aren't performing as well as they perhaps could in Europe, and it's about wider, for the good of the game, is developing young people, making the environment happy, making them flourish as individuals as well as football players, making sure that when the dream is taken away from them, they've been working hard at school and their education has been done properly, making sure that they slip back into, whether it's David's system or whether they're older, into the amateur system, and they continue to play football. So it's wider than just the focus on, if we miss this one nugget, then we're not going to miss out on compensation system. It's about the greater good. So I think there's an intellectual argument here that needs to be debated and had for football before we can move forward.
Thank you.
I think that's us concluded our question. I don't know if you've got any last comments you want to add. If not, can I thank you all very much for coming along this morning. I think your contribution has been exceptionally useful. We're also going to be hearing at a later date from the Commissioner for Young People, and that's really informed our thinking, but I'm sure the conversation will continue. And can I suspend until we change the panel? Thank you very much. If I can call the meeting back to order, and can I now welcome our second panel of the morning, Andrew McKinley of the Scottish Football Association and Neil Doncaster of the Scottish Professional Football League. And as with the previous panel, we'll go straight to the questions, but can I welcome you here today? Can I maybe just start off by asking how many children and young people are currently registered within the Club Academy Scotland system, and what proportion are expected to graduate, if I can use that term, to play professionally for Scottish clubs?
I'll take that one. Okay. There are 3,500 within Club Academy Scotland. I can't give you a percentage of how many are expected to graduate. It will be a small amount of that. What I would say, though, around that, and it's important in the current context, is I think it was mentioned by one of the previous panellists that as part of Project Brave, we are looking at that number. I don't think there is an acknowledgement that that's far too many. It's Club Academy Scotland is supposed to be the elite end of the game. And I think David used the phrase jersey fillers. We need to look at that. It needs to be cut down, and Project Brave is looking at that to make sure that there is more of an expectation that if you're in that you're likely to succeed. I took the point on earlier on, listening to the evidence, that getting that balance right between the expectation and not dashing someone's hopes, I think that's a really good point and a really difficult balance to lie.
Portion is the dropout rate is, as opposed to those who are not successful, a dropout rate, and is there any analysis, any conversation with young people who decide to chuck it, for a better phrase, but what has motivated that desire to leave?
On the first point, I don't have numbers for dropout rates from Club Academy Scotland. On the second point, one of the things we're very keen to do, and we've worked with the Scottish Youth FA in this, and it's had teething problems, but I think we're now at a good place in it, is around when boys do drop out, we want to find a path for them back to the recreational game. They've often come from the recreational game in the first place, and therefore it's important that you don't want to lose them entirely to the game. And so what we've done is we've worked through issues, usual data protection type issues, to make sure that those names are available so that the clubs that maybe they've been with previously or other recreational clubs can pick them up again, to make sure that they do still enjoy and play football.
Mm-hmm. In your letter to the Children and Young People's Commissioner in November 2015, you set out a series of measures to be put in place in response to recommendations made by the Commissioner. And we're also going to come to questions and specific issues relating to the measures. But briefly, could you confirm whether the measures set out have now been rolled out, and what processes are in place for monitoring by the Wellbeing Panel?
Yes, of course. All of them other than one are in place, and the one that's not in place is not because we don't want to put it in place. We will put it in place. I think it's a fundamentally important one, and it's around having this standard pack that clubs give to individuals at the beginning of the season. We are still working on that, so I don't want to mislead the panel on that that's in place. The others are we're all brought in by new rules. I think that standard pack is appropriate. When we were here last time, and I think it was Mr. McDonald actually was here last time, and he was shown the form that had to be signed by the parents, and that's an area that we need to work on more to make sure. I take on board the fact, and we've had this discussion before, that when parents are there with children signing forms, the last thing they're wanting to do is to get into the minutiae of all the registrations, etc. So it's an area we do need to make sure we get that in plain English, so there's a clear understanding of what they're entering into.
Okay, thanks very much. Maurice Corrie.
Yes, can I refer, gentlemen, to the 28-day period? The new measures, which include enabling a player to give 28 days' notice, after which they could return to the recreational game. If a player chose to exercise this, but after a period of time they wish to return to academy football at a different club, what conditions would apply to that return?
The main ones around the reimbursement of training costs, but it would depend on the particular circumstances, and that would be something for the Children's Wellbeing Panel to consider at the appropriate time. But the main one would be reimbursement of training costs that had been incurred by the initial club.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks, yeah.
Rona Mackay.
Yes, I'd like to sort of press you on the issue of the standard pack you mentioned you were working on. Can you give us, can you tell us more about that? How long will it take to actually have that?
It has to be in for the beginning of next season. Basically, the crucial bit for that pack is at the end of each year. We only brought the new rules in at the beginning of this season, so they're new for this season. So therefore, we have to work on them. That must be in for the beginning of next season.
Do you have a figure for the current percentage of players reporting that they actually understand the terms of registration prior to the form being signed? Do you have an idea of how many?
Well, it was actually, I think it was Mr. Little in the last session gave a percentage. That came from our own analysis. That's not so it was talked about that 55% fully understood. It was a bit more than just we're aware, fully understood. So I accept that, and that is why that's an area that we need to work on. Totally appreciate.
Place for the next season.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Angus MacDonald.
Thanks, Convener. We've heard some discussion regarding compensation during the previous panel session. So we've also had submissions that we've received making reference to a compensation scheme being a FIFA requirement. So how prescriptive is this requirement about the exact arrangements of the compensation scheme?
The scheme that has to be in place, the FIFA requirement, and I think it was in my first letter to the Commissioner, we actually referred to it specifically. But basically, the FIFA requirement is that all associations have to have regulations for movement between clubs, so within a domestic sphere, that provide for a system to reward clubs for investing in the training and education of young players. It's about reimbursement for them investing in the training and education of young players. The matrix, and again the suggestion has been given that the matrix, that these numbers are somehow plucked out of thin air. We did quite a lot of work, this goes back 3 or 4 years ago, around the amounts that are spent by the clubs at the different levels. And so the matrix ties into what level a club is within Club Academy Scotland. Having said that, and this is a crucial point, and it's picking up again on something that was said earlier, the suggestion then is that if you want to go from a higher club to a lower club, that would be impossible because the higher club had spent more. And that the regulations are done in such a way that that's not the way it works. The lower club would pay the amount as if they had been training to make sure that movement should be able to happen.
And in practice, has that happened?
Has movement taken place?
Yeah.
Well, I guess from our perspective, what we did around the matrix is we brought in 2015, in the summer of 2015, we brought in a dispute resolution procedure to make sure that where there were issues, because and the reason we brought that in, sorry, I should take a step back, the reason we brought that in is we spent quite a lot of time, and I think I gave evidence last time in 2014 to this committee around this point, that in my time, which would have been 2 years at that point, within the Scottish FA, there had only been a handful of these brought to our attention. That's more than you want, I accept that, for the particular individuals involved. But we had dealt with them on an ad hoc basis. We had come to, we'd effectively mediated, and we'd made sure that satisfactory arrangements were made. However, what we did, we appreciated that was ad hoc. We brought in a dispute resolution procedure in 2015 where there are disputes around it. And to date, that dispute resolution procedure has never been triggered.
Okay, thank you.
Can I ask on that, in any other walk of life, if I'm working for a company and they train me and I get a new job because I've benefited from that training, under what set of circumstances would my old employer be asked able to get money from my new employer?
I'd take it slightly differently, an analogy around sport. For a lot of elite sport and a lot of other sports, the children that are involved in that pay to be involved in that. They pay the clubs that they're involved in on a monthly basis. The elite level of football here, the clubs are doing, the players do not pay.
They're playing for a club which then benefits from their playing. Their business benefit. I mean, it's not as if they're sitting there training them, giving them skills which they don't then deploy in the interests of the club.
No, I appreciate that. There's also a suggestion here that there's loads of these payments being made per year, and I'm not aware of there actually being many payments.
But these compensation disputes are disputes amongst clubs. They're not really about the young person.
Well, the point of the rules is that the young person should not be stopped. That should be between the two clubs, absolutely.
So do you accept the description of somebody who could end up signing a contract at 11 and being stuck there till they're 23 before they can move on?
I've not seen it in practice. I've not seen that issue. That issue's not come before us.
I accept it's technically possible. I accept that.
If it's technically possible, is it acceptable or unacceptable? Even if it's a technicality, even if it actually hasn't happened yet, but could technically happen, if it did happen, would it be unacceptable?
It would be unacceptable if a player was frozen out of football for that period of time, absolutely.
Okay, can I come in there? Would you mind?
Mm-hmm.
Firstly, I very much welcome the opportunity to talk to the committee. I think there's a lot of misinformation out there, and certainly I want to do whatever I can, and I'm sure Andrew's the same, to ensure that we bring as much clarity to the debate as possible. I think whenever we're talking about movement of players and compensation systems, it's important that there is a balance in place, and there's a balance between the interests of the young children and the interests of the clubs. Ultimately, if there is no incentive for clubs to invest time and money in developing these young players, then they won't do it. And that's what the system that we have in place aims to do, is to develop young players, give them the opportunity to succeed and follow their dreams, but also not unduly curtail freedom. So it's about getting that right balance in place. My belief is that the system that we have in place achieves and strikes that appropriate balance. I think we've made a number of important and positive changes to the rules and regulations, both in relation to the SPFL and mainly on the Scottish FA, and that those changes have improved the concerns that did exist. And I think we've ended up with a system that, you know, needs time to be to bed in and be monitored as to how successful it has been in protecting the interests of young players, but also ensuring that clubs continue to have a strong incentive to develop and invest a lot of time and money in developing those players.
Okay. Brian?
What you're suggesting there, that clubs are the only way that kids can be developed within the sport, can I suggest to you that the balance should always be in towards the welfare of the child? There are other avenues from which children can be developed within sport. I think it's interesting, I was listening to you there, there's many, many other sports where talented children, and one of the things I think that I need to point out here is enthusiastic, talented children should not be classed as elite, as has been suggested here. Elite sports people are those at the highest international level and senior. And I think that's where one of the things here that's coming across to me. There are many other sports where talented youngsters make it into national squads, where they therefore don't have to pay anymore as part of that. I just find it strange that we're talking here about the clubs being the only avenue for which kids can be developed within the sport.
And I absolutely take that point. I don't think I am suggesting that clubs are the only avenue, but they are an avenue. Clubs do spend a lot of time and money, their own money, in investing in youth. And in most cases, you know, that investment doesn't come to anything because the players don't go on to become elite professional players. But in the circumstances where they do and they become sought after, particularly from bigger, more wealthy clubs south of the border, there has to be protection in place to ensure that clubs are appropriately compensated for the investment that they've made. At the same time, the absolute prime focus has to be on the welfare of players, and I believe that the system that's been brought in and the rule changes that we've together introduced over the last few years have been absolutely focused on player welfare and have achieved that appropriate balance, ensuring that players' rights are fully respected, whilst at the same time continuing to ensure that clubs have an incentive to invest. If we remove that incentive, then we will remove many of the opportunities that exist for young players, and I can't see how that can be in the interests of those young players.
You're saying there that the issue is that the bigger clubs and the clubs south of the border are suckling. To me, that would suggest that there's the problem extends outside of Scotland then, because again, that's all I'm interested, quite frankly, is in the welfare of the child and the child's ability to play within sport. Would you not agree that we need to put pressure on elsewhere as well as within our own game?
I'm sure Andrew's got a report that I'm sure he'll want to refer to in a moment, which talks about the scale of the problem. I think the system that we have in place at the present, where we have any form of dispute, where there is a concern about a player being having his or her freedom curtailed, we have rules in place to ensure that their interests are at the heart of the considerations going forward. And we, particularly the Scottish FA, would want to get involved and to help resolve those issues. And that happens in practice. So I suspect that's why we haven't had disputes go all the way to the children's panel, because actually they get resolved, and they get resolved in the right way, with the children's welfare being at the heart of the debate. I suspect it might be appropriate to give evidence of these.
I just wanted to pick up on, because I totally take the point, it's wider than Scotland, and it's important to look at that. And it was a crucial part of the consideration around the 15 to 17 year old point, was around this upheaval point of children to England. England, we are in a difficult position because we have the wealthiest league in the world on our doorstep. They are able to, pardon the colloquial, but they're able to take a punt. And we put that in there, that it was important for us from a welfare consideration that we didn't allow the English clubs just to come in and take our talent just like that. Now, that was scoffed at. It's quite often been scoffed at to me, say, well, you've got no evidence of that. That's just not happening. And just 2 weeks ago, a report came out from, and I'll just read parts of it, and I'm happy to send it on to the committee. The CIS Football Observatory monthly report for December 2016 on the international mobility of minors in football. And of almost 600 footballers who moved abroad before the age of 18 and who currently play in clubs at the top 31 divisions in UEFA, almost a third of them, the destination was England, 180 minors. The report, which was fully explored in the French language book Slow Foot, where it states that players having left their country under the age of 18 have, on average, less rewarding careers than footballers who left with more experience under their belt. And it says, whilst this has for some time been the suspicion of observers of the trade in minors, the obvious conclusion is that it is the money within the market that is dictating the movement of youths rather than development of their footballing potential in secure and supporting environments. The authors claim that the premature international migration of inexperienced players poses serious risks for both the footballers concerned and the teams recruiting them. And so I'm just giving that from an independent around why we were genuinely, I know there's a view that we look at this through one prism and we don't look at it from a children's welfare perspective, but genuinely around the 15 to 17 year old point, we were really concerned, people in the working group were really concerned about this ability of the English clubs to come in and take the players.
I do understand that, and I'm aware of Arsene Wenger's actually one of the main protagonists of this, especially pulling them out of France, but that doesn't get away from the fact that practice may not be the best interest of the child. And by creating a system in Scotland that backs that up, even though you're trying to protect the football clubs, which is my worry, that doesn't make it right.
We're trying to strike a balance. I don't know, Neil.
I think it's absolutely about the balance. And if you create the absolute freedom for young players to move as they wish, then what will inevitably happen is that the most talented will simply go to the very biggest and wealthiest clubs, particularly south of the border, at the very earliest opportunity because of the understandable lure of money. And it's difficult to see how that's in their developmental best interests. But from a Scottish perspective, what it will absolutely do is to remove any incentive from our professional clubs to invest in youth development. We had a presentation at the Scottish FA's convention recently from a club south of the border, and their model is now not to invest any money in the lower levels of youth development, but simply to hoover up the talented players who don't quite make it in the top level academies. And what that's effectively doing is then removing opportunities for the lower age groups and reducing the investment in the lower age groups. So I do think that it's important that we strike a balance. Absolute freedom may in the short term be seen to help the players, but will absolutely remove the number of opportunities and the investment in the development of those young players. So it's appropriate that we have a balanced system that incentivises clubs to invest, but also creates appropriate freedoms and respects absolutely the rights of the individual and the child. My view, genuinely, is that we've arrived at a fair, balanced system. It may not be perfect, and there may be further improvements that can be made, but I do believe that we've made significant progress, that we've introduced a number of very significant changes as a result of this process, and those changes have been positive. And what we should rightly do is to have time to see how they work in practice, and if there are any further improvements that need to be made, look at that time after we've evaluated how successful they've been. But at the moment, we are not seeing any evidence of unresolved disputes and players, young players, having their appropriate freedoms being curtailed.
Can I ask you, what has the compensation scheme, which is operating in Scotland at present, been compared to schemes in other countries?
All countries have similar type schemes. What I would say on that is that there's actually a move in other countries across the UEFA jurisdiction to extend the 3-year point. There's a feeling in other countries it should actually be longer than that. That's not something that we're suggesting, just to make it clear.
And the reason for that is not protection of the clubs, it's actually development of the young players. The view is that premature movement of players actually reduces their ability to develop as professional players. So the view elsewhere is that they should be kept with their home clubs for longer. Our view is that 3 years remains an appropriate time at this stage, with the protections that exist to enable players to move in appropriate circumstances, and the regulatory bodies have a role in ensuring that happens.
Chair, can I just ask a further question? Are there any other key differences that you found from that investigation, apart from what you've just spoken about?
There's a number of jurisdictions where the compensation is payable on the awarding of a first professional contract. We have a system in place which deals with compensation where they move, where the players move prior to a first professional contract. There's no rights and wrongs here. It's a difference in approach. I believe that our system is right and appropriate, and is appropriate to Scotland.
Okay. Thank you.
Laura McKay.
Thank you. Yes, you may just have answered my question, actually. You'll have heard from the previous panel about there's a high level of concern about the compensation culture in children's football, and I was going to ask if you share that concern, and if you have a figure or a percentage of players moving between Club Academy Scotland clubs, and when, how often that compensation payment is triggered, just to give us an idea of the level of that.
Andrew may have more statistics than I've got to hand, but certainly my experience of the clubs is that they work very hard to resolve bona fide disputes. You know, where, for example, a young player's family is moving from one region to another within Scotland, there'll be a lot of work done behind the scenes to ensure that the compensation framework that exists is not a barrier to that player moving. And you know, clubs are very respectful, genuinely, of the rights of the young player. And if there's any doubt, then it'll end up with the governing bodies to get involved and to find a resolution.
Just to clarify, you approve and would not change the present compensation system?
No, I genuinely believe it strikes an appropriate balance between the interests of the young player and the need to incentivise clubs to invest.
Thank you. Do you have a figure, Mr. McKinley?
I don't have an exact figure. What I would say is, and I think I touched upon it, is it's very rare for there to be compensation or the reimbursement of training cost payments. I would pick up on the point Neil made there around where there's a couple of things. One thing we did bring in, it's not been mentioned at all here today, is we brought in a new rule around game time. So if a player doesn't get a particular amount of time, they are allowed to leave the club at the end of the season, even during that 3-year point. It was a feeling was that clubs were just hanging on to players and weren't using them at all.
What is the game time? Do you know?
It's 25%. On the other point, as I said, there's not many examples that I'm aware of where it's actually paid.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Brian Mitchell.
There's one specific area where some concerns have been noted,
is the phrase subject to appropriate welfare considerations in respect of Club Academy Scotland players being able to play for school teams. You've probably heard this issue discussed in previous panels. Could you explain what these considerations are and why they were a benefit to the children and young people affected?
I'll take that one because it's quite an easy response to that. That was in the initial recommendations. That is not what's in the rules. There's no such... That's not in the rules at all. They should be entitled to play for their school teams. We took out the wording around subject to welfare considerations when we came to the actual rules. That was in the initial recommendation. We took on board the comments of the Children's Commissioner on that point, and therefore when it actually came into the rules, it says that the child should be allowed to play for their school team. I accept that there will be discussions going on that I'll be unaware of that were mentioned by the school's FA between clubs and schools, but the rule is clear that the club should not be preventing a player from playing for their school team where they wish to do so.
One of the issues identified in relation to not changing the multi-year registration period for players in the 15 to 17 age group is the potential for negative impact on health and wellbeing, and in particular the upheaval both to England and within Scotland would be disruptive for family life and education. Why would decisions about what would be in the best interest of family life or the education of a young person be matters for clubs or the SFA rather than young person and their parents or carers?
I mean, I guess we've just talked about the background to that and we've just given you answers to that. The other side to that, and it was evidence that we gave last time, I think in 2014, and it's probably important that you should hear from a club, and it was John Murray then of Hearts that came and explained more around the 15 to 17 year old and gave good evidence to the committee as to why that age group was so important from a growth perspective. We've talked a lot today about often a difficult 3 years. I think when you look back at the evidence from 2014, he talks about how the growth spurts that children have gone through and Osgood Schlatters and these sorts of things, and he gave good evidence on that as to why it was an important period for stability for the welfare of the child.
I don't know if James Donna.
Thank you, Convener. I've got a couple of questions, if that's okay. Thank you. The first one is, I want to go back to you on the misinformation point that was raised by Mr. Doncaster earlier on, but you talked earlier about two things. One is that the English FA is by far the richest, the EPL is by far the richest league in the world, and then you quoted from that report. Now, the quotes you gave from that report quite clearly protect the clubs, because at the end of the day, if clubs are going to, the Scottish clubs, if clubs are going to pay compensation, then the English clubs, more than any other clubs, are able to pay that compensation. So the amount of compensation means absolutely nothing in terms of the welfare of the child, because if these English clubs want those players, they'll just come in and get them. So how does that help the welfare of the child? And that seemed to be, you were trying to say, it appeared to me you were trying to say that this was all about the benefit of the club, all the benefit of the child, to make sure that he's not disrupted. But if they want him, they'll get him.
The point, well, it's a different compensation. First, it's a different compensation scheme cross-border, but I don't want to particularly go...
It's about money for the club and nothing to do with the child.
It's fine. The point, though, was actually more around the stability of the system and the fact that the system, there's a good chance that the system would fall apart and we wouldn't have a system and there wouldn't be anything for children. And that was what the main point was about, around the welfare of the children in the wider sense. I don't know, Neil, I don't know if you want to.
I don't really get that, but do you want to come in, Mr. Doncaster?
I can only echo the points previously made, which is that there has to be an appropriate balance. And ultimately, clubs are investing their own money in very extensive player developmental operations. They're doing their best to turn raw talent into future professional players. And they're doing that because they believe that they will either get the benefit of those players playing for them, or should the player decide to go elsewhere, then those clubs will be appropriately compensated for the money they've invested in those players. And if you dismantle the framework, then you remove the incentive for those clubs to develop young players, and you'll end up with a significant lack of investment in development of young players. And I can't see how that can be for the benefit of either the Scottish game or ultimately for the young players involved?
As it was talked about earlier on, the Bosman ruling, everybody said the world of football was going to come to a crashing halt and didn't. And what you find is that football very often reinvents itself round about the rules that are in place. I would suggest, as others have, that the child should be at the centre of all these things we're talking about. I want to talk about the misinformation point earlier on. Is it misinformation to say that three-year contract means that the club has all the control and the player has none?
It's a three-year registration. It's not a contract.
Right, yes, you're right. That's worse, because if it's a three-year contract, the child would be getting paid for those 3 years. It's a three-year registration, which the club can break, but the child can't.
Well, Andrew, do you want to give details of that?
The club has a one-way option at the end of the first year and the second year to extend it. We also talked earlier, I've also mentioned that there are opportunities now to come out, the game time rule that we've now brought in, the 28-day rule to go back to recreational football that we've now brought in, which we didn't have previously. I think the other point to make it clear is that in practice, it's not in the best interests of a club to keep hold of a player that doesn't want to be there. And therefore, in practice, there are many occasions where there's agreement between the players and the clubs that a player moves on, whether that's at the end of the season or during the season.
Why do we have that three-year registration that only benefits one side then?
We've given our reasons as to why. I know you don't accept those reasons, but we've given those reasons.
You're right, I don't accept the reasons. The other piece of misinformation I think you might have been alluding to, but you can correct me if I'm wrong, is the one round about wages being paid to young players in Scotland. I mean, there's £10 a week that's been mentioned, £1 a week that's been mentioned. An amateur club playing professional, getting players to sign professional forms at £1 a week. Do you accept that this is happening, or is this misinformation? And if it is happening, why is it happening, and what action are the SFA and the SPFL taking to stop it?
Okay, well, we saw the report in the Daily Record last week at the same time as everyone else, so we weren't given any advance notification that was going in there, so not given any opportunity to comment beforehand. We saw a report that three SPFL clubs were alleged to have breached national minimum wage legislation. So I'm sure it won't surprise you to learn that we've written to each of the clubs concerned, ask for their comments, ask for full information, and we will investigate fully the allegations that have been made. And it would be premature to comment on those investigations at this time. What I can absolutely assure you, however, is that all SPFL clubs are fully bound by national minimum wage legislation. They are bound by the law of the land, like every other club, every other business. And it would be contrary to our rules, it were a club to be not paying national minimum wages. The obligation to pay at least national minimum wage is included within the scope of our standard professional contract. So we will absolutely investigate the claims that have been made. What I can do, however, is appropriate perhaps to quote from Sterling Albion, was one of the clubs mentioned within that report in the Daily Record. They put a statement on their website, and that statement said that Stirling Albion FC can confirm that the case study referred to by the Daily Record has been fully addressed and resolved with the player in question. The club would like to thank PFA Scotland for their support and cooperation in bringing this matter to a satisfactory conclusion. The club can confirm, with the resolution of this isolated case, that everyone on the payroll at Stirling Albion FC exceeds the minimum wage requirements as laid out by HMRC. Wherever any any player ends up in dispute with a club over any matter, whether it's national minimum wage or any other matter pertinent to the contract, we have a free dispute resolution procedure in place that clubs can that the players can avail themselves on. They can bring a dispute to the SPFL, and the SPFL will adjudicate on that complaint. And that's happened on a number of occasions. We haven't yet had any case brought to us in respect of national minimum wage.
Can I ask what your view is of clubs seeking advice on how they get round the national minimum wage?
Well, I think it's important to put the report about the legal advice from Harper McLeod that again was referred to in that article. Our clubs recognise that all clubs have to pay national minimum wage at least, and that all clubs are bound by that legislation. And the report that was put together by Harper McLeod was designed to educate clubs as to how the law operated, and it is quite a difficult area. So, for example,
to work out if somebody's paying, you know, an X amount an hour, they wouldn't have a contract to give them a pound a week.
No, and I'm not suggesting that...
What education is required for a club to understand if they're employing somebody and managing their time for 16 hours a week, they might be reasonably expected to get 16 times what the minimum wage is rather than a pound a week or a pound
absolutely.
A month.
Absolutely, and it comes down to how many hours they're working, and that's where...
How many hours would they have to work in order to get a pound a month?
I'm not suggesting that a pound a week is in any way compliant with either national minimum wage.
So I'm asking you, what would your action then be against any club who has a contract which says that somebody's getting a pound a week or a pound a month?
As I've said, we are investigating the allegations made against our member clubs, and we will look very carefully about what has happened. We're in the middle of that process, and you know, if it's appropriate to take further action against the clubs concerned, then we will do that. But please be in no doubt, all clubs are bound by national minimum wage legislation, and all clubs have to pay at least national minimum wage as part of a professional contract on the SPFL standard form.
And given what we've said about imbalance of power between the club and an individual young person who may have an ambition to play, is it reasonable to test the effectiveness of the system by the number of young people who might have had the confidence or courage to go and take on their club? Because I hear what you say about, oh, well, you know, you don't hold on to a young person that you don't want to use any longer. I think there's at least some anecdotal evidence that some young people do get frozen out, but they're not able to move on because of the power of the club itself.
I would hope that were that to be the case, then they would come forward, and they would come forward to PFA Scotland, to ourselves.
It's difficult for them in circumstances where their future and their ambitions are at stake to make a name for themselves as a troublemaker within any football club. It's not something that they're going to comfortably do if it then has an impact on their ability to get a game elsewhere.
Well, players do bring cases to us to adjudicate, and we adjudicate on those cases and deal with disputes that exist between players and clubs. And it's a very effective process. It's a free process. It's very easy to implement. The PFA Scotland themselves advise a number of players in relation to those cases. It's an effective system that works. But in no cases that we've seen has national minimum wage been an issue at all. Please be in no doubt, all clubs are bound by national minimum wage legislation, and we will investigate any allegations that are made against our clubs.
You have to just contrast with that the fact that there are contracts that we've seen that for a pound a month and a pound a week, and anyone who's educated in how the national minimum wage existed wouldn't have those contracts. I think that's something you may want to look at further. Richard first and then James.
Yeah, I mean, I had a look at the SPFL rules and regulations, which are quite extensive, and it's got a 10-page glossary at the beginning from adjudication through to visiting clubs. It goes from M, membership criteria, to O. There's nothing in the glossary that begins with the letter N. Perhaps national minimum wage could be introduced in the next edition. I just want to go back to something I raised in the earlier session, which was about the role of agents and intermediaries. I mean, we're dealing with a crisis in football at the moment around child sex abuse, and it appears from evidence that we were presented with earlier on that there is no PVG checks made on agents and intermediaries in the game. I wonder whether you could perhaps address that, Mr. McKinley.
Can I deal with the first point on national minimum wage, and then perhaps if Mr. McKinley deals with the agents and intermediaries? In relation to national minimum wage, please again be advised, be in no doubt, that the obligation to pay a national minimum wage is incorporated within the SPFL standard professional contract. So all clubs are bound to pay national minimum wage. And if we see any allegations, whether it's through the Daily Record or elsewhere or through PFA Scotland, then we will investigate whether clubs have indeed breached our rules. That is absolutely clear. And we are doing that in relation to the report of the three clubs in last week's Daily Record article.
Could be more proactive, Mr. Doncaster, couldn't you?
Well, I think, you know, ultimately the HMRC has primary jurisdiction in relation to national minimum wage. You know, we aren't a police force. Wherever there is an allegation that any of our clubs is in breach of the rules, whether it be national minimum wage or any other rule, then we will absolutely investigate, and I think it's appropriate that we do so.
About the intermediaries?
Of course.
It was touched upon by Mr. Wishart in his evidence around the fact that this area was deregulated by FIFA. We do have regulations, however, one of the points about that is that intermediaries do not come under our jurisdiction until such time as they carry out a transaction. At the time that they carry out a transaction, they have to sign a declaration form. One of the points in that form is that they have to give a declaration that they have met the required criteria to allow them to work for minors under the current guidelines, rules and regulations as set out by Disclosure Scotland or such other relevant government agency of my country of domicile. The point being that you get a lot of agents that are not, or you will get some agents, I should say, that are not Scottish and therefore not covered. But there is a self-declaration. I accept, I think that's an area I need to look at and see if there's more that we can do in that area. I do have oversight of the child abuse matter that you've alluded to. I will have oversight of the independent review that will be set up by us, and I suspect this will be an area that they look into.
Okay, thank you.
Can I
again follow up on the point about wages? As the regulatory body for professional football clubs, can you confirm that you didn't know that some of the clubs were paying their children £1 a week? Because I find that astonishing. You didn't know until you read it in the press.
Yeah, we moved from a situation prior to the merger of the Scottish Premier League and Scottish Football League in 2013. In 2014, we moved to a situation where instead of having three separate registration systems, we effectively have one which is administered by the Scottish FA. So we don't have sight of contracts that are signed between clubs and players. Effectively, eligibility to play in SPFL competitions arises due to a Scottish FA registration. So, no, I did not have knowledge of any clubs paying £1 a week.
There's no dialogue or real interaction about the registration or the contracts or the payments being made? That's just not anything you've concerned yourself with?
No, I'm absolutely concerned if clubs are not paying national minimum wage. That's precisely because...
My point is you didn't know that, is my point. You didn't
no,
know
it's precisely, that. It's precisely because we are concerned that all clubs should pay at least national minimum wage that we asked our solicitors to prepare a report for clubs to help them ensure compliance with national minimum wage legislation. It's not as portrayed elsewhere that it's somehow to get around the rules, it's to be compliant with the rules. And it's part of the SPFL standard contract that all clubs should pay national minimum wage. That is part of the framework that exists. So where there are allegations that any club is not paying national minimum wage, then we will look very carefully at that. And the grey area that I spoke about earlier is where, for example, you have a situation in the development of young players, you will often find that clubs on away trips will take young players with them to get used to the idea of travelling with the squad without any expectation that they would actually play on that day. Now that technically is probably working time. And the point about national minimum wage is that because clubs have to be compliant with national minimum wage and have to be paying players for any hour that they're working, what the national minimum wage may create is a situation where clubs are no longer able to take players with them on those trips, because they wouldn't perhaps be compliant with national minimum wage. Be that as it may.
You're suggesting that clubs can't afford to do that?
At the lower level, that's absolutely the case. And that's why...
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. And that's what we're talking about here, is generally part-time clubs that are really struggling to get by and will in many cases be struggling to pay even national minimum wage, but have to. With the more wealthy full-time clubs, I'd be certainly very surprised if we were in situations where national minimum wage was relevant. But all clubs, whether they're part-time or full-time, all SPFL clubs, their players, those that are on professional contracts as opposed to amateur contracts, those professional contracts will be on the basis that national minimum wage is part of that.
Do you want to comment on this, Mr. McKinley?
All I would say is that we, the Scottish FA, we register players. The registrations team, which is a team made up of three individuals, I checked this on Monday, to date this year have processed in excess of 18,000 transactions. They do not consider the terms of the contracts. So I just wanted to make that clear. We absolutely not aware, I was not aware
of that issue.
There's somebody with a contract that's illegal.
Yeah, under the registration system, you can, yes.
And under what set of circumstances would that be defined as a registration scheme worthy of its name?
Well, we do not look at the terms of all the contracts. As I said, there's 18,000 transactions a year. No, I know.
I don't think having lots and lots of registrations a justification for having a registration scheme that doesn't meet basic legal requirements. Surely. Or am I missing something? That you would register somebody who's been registered in circumstances where they're expected to work for £1 a month, £1 a week, where there are conditions that are placed on them. It's not like a 0 hours contract. They can't go and do something else. No. Is that not the business of the SFA?
I accept the point you're making. I'm just telling you how the registration system works.
So is this something you're going to change?
We have no immediate plans to change the registration system.
So we have, on the one hand, somebody who doesn't know that it's happened, that even if you do know something about it, you're registering people without reference to that and you have no plans to change it.
Can I offer the absolute assurance that where we have an allegation that any of our 42 SPFL clubs is not paying national minimum wage on a professional contract, we will investigate that because, on the face of it, that's not compliant with our rules. So we will look at it and investigate it, and we'll absolutely be in a position to comment on it when that investigation has happened.
You have more confidence that you will set in place a system that prevents people from trying to break the law, rather than hoping that somebody who is having their rights denied will have the confidence or the ability to take that club on. Would it not be more reasonable, which I think is probably happens in the rest of the world, we're registering you, we're responsible for you, you will meet the legal standards that are required, and we will check that you're doing them. We'll not wait till somebody complains.
With respect, I think that's an unfair suggestion. We cannot be the police force. It's the HMRC's primary responsibility. It's a bit like suggesting that the Scottish Government is somehow responsible for MSPs having car insurance in place. And that would be ludicrous. All clubs are businesses within Scotland, and they are bound by the law. And the law insists that national minimum wage is paid. And if it's not being paid, then we will investigate. So it's appropriate that where allegations are made, we have the primary responsibility to investigate that on behalf of the football authorities. And no doubt HMRC would have an interest as well.
So just to be clear, your registration scheme bears no relation to issues around the law. Individual businesses have to comply, I agree. Why have a registration system at all then? If you have no authority over them, I think you're operating inside FIFA rules, which you've signed up for. But you have no authority over clubs who may be breaking the law. You have no ability to sanction them.
We're saying at all. We're saying that where it's alleged that clubs are in breach of national minimum wage legislation, we will investigate it and take appropriate action.
The right to take action once you find out it's happening, but you won't set in place circumstances to make sure that it's not happening in the first place.
You can't know how many hours players are working for. Only that will be known to the clubs and the players. So if it's alleged that you've got a situation where players are working and they're not being paid the national minimum wage, if that's alleged, then we will absolutely look at it. And it's been alleged in the Daily Record last week, and we are investigating.
I'm sure I can't be the only person here who feels that's not quite the response we would have been hoping for, but I recognise that's continuing to be what you're saying. I don't know if there's any other questions. Brian?
Well, I was actually going to say that, that we recognise that there's some, there's good people throughout the whole of football who do have the best interests of the game and the best interests of young players in mind. And we are talking about 12-year-olds and up. And if all the elements of Scottish football were to start with a clean sheet of paper and start with the welfare, enjoyment and longevity in the game of the child, would we end up with the current system, which I would doubt? Would words like agent, compensation, wages and disputes end up on that paper? And is there a willingness from the SFA and the SPFL to engage in these discussions in a further process? But my concern would be, how much influence do clubs have as a block to any change?
Well, Your question seems to presuppose that we're somehow different from the rest of the world. And, you know, the fact is that agents' compensation and such like are a matter of reality in world football. But it exists, and we have to deal with reality as it is, not as we wish it were. And I think we have in place a fair system and a balanced system that respects the rights of children, that offers an incentive for clubs to invest in development of young players, and protects the rights of children within that. It may not be a perfect system, and it may be that further improvements can be made. We have made a number of significant changes over the last few years in response to this process. I would urge all concerned to give those changes time to bed in and to reflect on whether they've been successful or whether further changes are needed. It's only appropriate that we do that, and we see to what extent they've been successful in achieving their aims.
As I say, I completely accept we're dealing with reality here, and I find it incredulous here, but the reality is we're dealing with kids. And I just can't get my head around the fact that you're defending a system that will have compensation and kids and payment and £1 a week payments. I find it incredible to turn around and say it happens elsewhere doesn't make it right.
You are conflating a number of different issues. We are talking about, on the one hand, young players who are enjoying the football, are associated with clubs, and clubs are doing their best to invest in and develop as professional players in the for the future. That's entirely separate from a situation of professional players who will be at least the age of 16 on professional contracts, where national minimum wage at least has to be paid. You know, at the age of 12, they are clearly amateurs. They are clearly there to enjoy football primarily, but also where a club is investing in those players. You know, should there be a situation where another club wishes to take them into their system and develop them instead, then there's a system there to protect the investment that's been made by the first club. It's appropriate that that exists, because if it doesn't exist, there's no incentive to invest in the first place.
I've got very little time left. I'm going to allow the last few questions from committee members. But I would say that what you've just said is that somebody under 16 can be deemed to be somebody who can be the contract involved in compensation, so on. Clearly, minimum wage doesn't apply to them, but these other adult things apply to them. The irony might be that actually you're making a case for young people under 16 to be paid, and I just think it shows perhaps some of the difficulties around this. Morris, and then I think James is wanting in.
Thanks, Chair. I mean, I'm really quite seriously concerned about some of the comments that are coming from the panel. But would I ask you a question? Would you say that you were here to, in your work, preventing the exploitation of the young people or not?
Part of our role is absolutely to ensure that young players, young people, are dealt with appropriately and respected. And I believe that the system that exists at present does that effectively, whilst at the same time creating an incentive for clubs to invest time and money in developing them as players. I believe that appropriate balance is struck, and it's vital that we have a balanced system. If we end up in a system that is far too much one way or the other, it won't work, either because it doesn't respect the rights of the child or because it removes any incentive for the clubs to invest. So a balanced approach, I believe, is the right approach, and I do believe that we have that approach in place at present.
But just final quick one, but you seem to be reactive rather than proactive.
I think that's an unfair criticism. I think that we've made a number of positive changes in line with the discussions here, and in some cases we've taken them further. So, you know, the game time rule is an example of how we've gone beyond what's been recommended, how we removed the welfare consideration point from the right of the child to play school football. So I think we've been proactive. We'll continue to be proactive. I think we will be always keen to come along and ensure that we're dealing with facts rather than misinformation, which is out there in this area, and to ensure that we have the best possible system in place for Scottish football, but also for Scottish young people.
Thank you very much, Medina. Thanks for your indulgence this morning. A couple of things. One is that you talk about been part of the real world, and I have to say that two of the answers I got recently made me think that you're not really part of the wider society when you talk about the fact that you have an admin system that seems to just consist of one big rubber stamp that says, no wonder you could get through 18,000 so quickly. The other one is that because you don't pay the minimum wage, that you won't, the kids won't go on bus trips, which I think, if we're talking about the benefit of the child here, then surely what we're talking about is building them on. But the really important issue is, I want to go back to the minimum wage again, and I'm not going over stuff that's already been said, but HMRC, that if a minimum wage contract is not kept, then the contract is invalid. Are you telling me that when you do your investigation and you find that some of these people have been on less than minimum wage, those contracts will be invalid?
What I can absolutely assure you is that we will investigate any allegations that our clubs are not paying national minimum wage. It's fundamental as part of any professional contract signed by a club and registered with the Scottish FA that national minimum wage will be paid. So let's have that investigation. It's ongoing at present. And when we're in a position to comment on the outcome of that investigation, we'll absolutely do so.
You said HMRC's position that the contracts will be invalid.
Well, ultimately, you know, we will ensure that clubs abide by our rules, and it's part of a professional contract that national minimum wage is paid. But ultimately, HMRC do have primary jurisdiction in this, and I'm sure that they'll have looked at reports and that they'll be looking at it as we indeed are.
Pretty sure after today's evidence, we'll certainly be looking at things very closely. My very last question is on compensation. You continue to talk about compensation for the training that was put in to make these players the people that they are, the players that they are. What role do you, the SFA, I suppose, and the SPFL then have to make sure that the compensation is done for those who started these kids out in their career in the first place? Because they don't come fully formed or even semi-formed to football clubs. They've already been a lot of work done by youth clubs, guys like Willie and Scott and others.
There is some money that goes down the game. It's not a lot. I accept that. What often happens, and I know Willie, I've spoken to Willie a lot on this, and or has often happened in the past, is when players move from clubs like his up the game, they maybe get a bag of balls or something like that, and there's maybe not actual money. I accept that, and Willie would be able to give better evidence than I on how well that works these days. But no, I totally accept that that's where those players came from, and they are vitally important for the vibrancy of the game.
So why can't we put a system in place? I mean, because we've continued to talk about compensation and the importance of compensation, and clubs getting that so that they can continue to train the players or to make it worthwhile for the players. But yet we're asking the same people to do it for nothing or a bag of balls.
Well, I think in relation to professional clubs, they are very heavily licensed and regulated in relation to how their academy systems operate by the Scottish FA, that imposes very strict standards and requirements on those clubs and how they operate. So effectively, they're being told you have to work to a certain standard and invest to that standard, but in return, you know, you get compensation for money you've put into training and development when a player moves on. No, you know, those standards are not applicable to clubs below that level.
Yes, sir. I assure you that at that level, the money in comparative terms is much greater. Thank you very much, Convener. Thank you.
I'm just very conscious of time because we're time constrained because the Chamber sits from 20 to 12, so we are going to have to close the conversation here. I don't think it's by any stretch the end of the dialogue or the discussion, but I do want to thank our panel members for coming along today. I think we've learned a lot from that. We will be hearing from the Children and Young People's Commissioner of Scotland, and I think it may be at that point that we'll take the opportunity as a committee to reflect on what action we take next, because obviously we would want to test his view of what he's heard today against his own particular comments that he's made to us. So with that, can I thank our panel members again, thank our visitors, and I'll suspend for a couple of moments until we can move on to the next bit of business. Thank you.
Thank you.
bring the meeting back to order. Can I welcome Murdo Fraser, Rona Grant and Kate Forbes to the meeting for an item later on the agenda. I'm very conscious of time now, and we want to through as much as possible, but at the same time with giving enough time to each petition, which of course all of these are important, so it may be we end up deferring some of them, but we'll see how we get on. So the second final item for today is consideration of six continued petitions. The first petition, 1458, in the Register of Interest for Members of Scotland's Judiciary. This is by Peter Cherby. On a Register of Interest for Members of Scotland's Judiciary, members will recall that we had agreed to invite oral evidence on this petition from Professor Alan Paterson and from the Lord President. We will hear from Professor Paterson at our next meeting on 9th January. In response to the committee's invitation, the Lord President has sent a letter in which he requests more information about the questions that we wish to address to him. I wonder if members have any comments on this. Angus?
Thanks, Convener. I note the letter from the Lord President in which he states he was under the impression that this matter had concluded, and a little surprised that it's been raised once again. However, I think the letter from the petitioner, Peter Cherby, highlights that it would be remiss of this committee not to follow this petition through as far as we possibly can. And I think we're not at a stage yet where we have exhausted all our options. In addition, I've been made aware of issues where the recusal system may not be working as well as it should be. And the petitioner's letter would suggest that he's also aware of these issues too. So I'm pleased that Professor Paterson has indicated that he's available next month to give evidence to this committee. And I think we should perhaps wait until we've taken evidence from Professor Paterson before we consider our next steps. I'm not sure if we require to reply to the Lord President at this moment in time or if we should wait until once we've taken further evidence.
Might I suggest that we wait till we take evidence from Professor Paterson, if that's agreed, and then we can decide a course of action. Okay, thank you very much for that. We can then move on to petition 1480. The next petition for consideration is petition 1480 on Alzheimer's and dementia awareness and petition 1533 on abolition of non-residential social care charges for older and disabled people. Members will recall that our meeting on 29 September 2016, we asked the Scottish Government to respond to the issues raised in the petitioner's submissions. The Cabinet Secretary for Health and Sport has provided a response, noting that the Scottish Government will continue conduct a feasibility study into expanding free personal care and nursing care to people with dementia who are under 65. The timeframe for completing the study is summer 2017. The committee has also received a submission from Mr. Adamson, the petitioner for petition 1533. Mr. Adamson is concerned that the feasibility study has a narrow focus that is condition and age specific. Members will see from the clerk's note that the Session 4 Public Petitions Committee held an evidence session with the Cabinet Secretary on 6 October 2015. At that meeting, the Cabinet Secretary appeared to suggest that a funding system that's condition or age-specific would be unfair, and this might be something that members would wish to explore further with the Cabinet Secretary. Mr. Adamson is also concerned that the recent changes to the income threshold for care charging do not take account of the different costs of living across Scotland. Mr. Adamson suggests that some local authorities appear to have raised their social care charges despite the Scottish Government's recent increase in funding. For these reasons, he is concerned that progress is not being made towards achieving a fair social care charging system in Scotland. Members may know that I led a members' debate on 6 December in which issues relevant to the petition were debated, including the terms of the feasibility study and variations in charging between local authorities. I wonder if members have any comments or suggestions for action, which clearly an issue that's widely regarded as very important. Morris?
Yes, having spoken also in your debate, Chair, and it raised various issues, I think it would be appropriate really to, and having had the Cabinet Secretary there for Health and Sport, I think it would be appropriate to invite her to come to give evidence at a future meeting based on the information that was led on from that debate, and obviously she and her team have gone back to look at. We need to review that. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Yep. It would also be possible to have someone from COSLA come along.
Mm-hmm. Well, we could certainly explore that, but I think there's this mm-hmm. issue both, there's an issue about the fairness of social care charges at all, but also the different ways in which they're imposed in different parts of the country, and this age question, which is, you know, we know from Frank's Law, is something that's highly contentious as well.
Yes. The reasons of the issues that came up in the debate.
Isn't it?
It does seem that the debate is the petition's widening its scope at the moment. It's going into other areas. If we bring the Cabinet Secretary in, what specifically would be aiming for?
Well, I think what we're looking from the Cabinet Secretary is clarity around the feasibility study against what was said earlier on, where she was suggesting that any proposal that discriminated on the basis of age or condition would be very difficult to deal with. Okay. But if we can agree to explore the question of causal, but certainly to invite the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Sport to give evidence, would that be agreed?
Agreed.
Okay. Then move on to petition 1540, a permanent solution for the A83. Right? Yeah. We now turn to petition 1540 by Douglas Filland on a permanent solution for the A83. When we last considered this petition, we agreed to write to the Minister for Transport and Islands to ask for more information about the review of the National Transport Strategy and the Strategic Transport Projects Review. As members will see, information has been provided, and it would appear there is quite a long time frame for both these pieces of work. The work to be undertaken will involve some engagement events from our point of view. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action?
Yes, Chair, I do. I do have a fair knowledge of this project. It's in my ward, and I declare an interest as a councillor for Argyll Bute Council. The issue really revolves around, I think we should have before us a detailed plan of action in relation to options. There are three to four options that are fully aware to the Transport Minister, fully aware to the Council and the petitioners. And I think these need to be brought forward in a proper costed approach and evaluate them and what the Minister does, because I don't think responsible Minister really tells us anything.
Yeah. Well, I think it does say it's going to take quite a long time. I wonder whether what we might suggest is that it would be useful for the Scottish Government to hold a stakeholder event in Argyll and Bute to ensure that the views of people in the area would be taken into account, because there must be, presumably, the challenges of the immediate against the long term and the costs of the very long term proposals. That it would be simply to say, in some time we will be consulting on a strategy, doesn't, I think, I address either of these fully.
I think they could bring options forward. I mean, it might be just proposals, but I do know there are proposals there.
Okay. So we would see that's been hosted by the Scottish Government themselves, and we can see what response we get to that request. Is that agreed?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you for that. If we can then move on to petition. The next petition for consideration is petition 1577 by Rachel Wallace on adult cerebral palsy services. Members have a submission from the Scottish Government and the petitioner. Since the petition was lodged last year, we have now had three responses from the Scottish Government, the position of which appears to be unchanged. Members will see from the latest submission that the Scottish Government has again highlighted that funding is provided for a pilot programme being led by Bobath Scotland. The Scottish Government does not appear willing to commit to consulting on a national clinical pathway for adults with cerebral palsy, as called for by the petitioner. While the petitioner is supportive of Bobath Scotland's work, members will see from her submission that she is concerned that the project has a very narrow focus. In this regard, Ms Wallace explains that the pilot project is focused on the particular services provided by a single charity, rather than the full range of services available under the NHS and privately. Ms Wallace explains the full breadth of treatment required by adults with cerebral palsy includes occupational therapy, speech and language therapy, orthopaedic treatment and neurology. In the absence of a clinical pathway, it's up to the individual to navigate all of these services to find the right treatment for them. For these reasons, the petitioner views her call for a national clinical pathway as completely separate to the work being done by Bobath Scotland. Ms Wallace would welcome a consultation on this issue to allow a full range of clinicians to provide their views. And I wonder if members have comments or suggestions for action. And Murdo, I don't know if you want to maybe say something.
Thank you. Convener, this is quite a long-running petition from my constituent, Rachel Wallace. Progress has been quite slow. We do, however, have a meeting arranged with civil servants at the end of January with Rachel to discuss the possible ways forward. I think we'd be keen, at the very least, to see the petition carry on and be continued, and might be appropriate for the committee to consider continuing the petition till after that meeting, and then bring it back for reconsideration once that meeting's taken place, to see what the government's response is at that point.
Okay, would it be worthwhile, maybe in terms of organisation, that subject to what we hear about the report from that meeting, it might be something we would want to hear from the Minister for Public Health and Sport at the committee?
I think so. I think it's surprising there isn't a clinical pathway, quite frankly, for cerebral palsy. So I'd be quite keen to listen to the Minister.
And if it would seem that the petition is entirely satisfied subsequent to the meeting, then that may not be necessary, although I think there are issues that we would maybe even want a report back to the committee on about how this was being addressed. But I think that the complex needs of an adult with cerebral palsy is something that we would want to see the government responding to.
Yeah.
Is that agreed? Okay, thank you very much. And thanks very much, Murdo. Petition 1591, major redesign of healthcare services in Skye, Lochalsh and South West Ross. And can I, as I said, welcome both Rhoda Grant and Kate Forbes for this item. This petition is by Katrina MacDonald on behalf of SOS NHS. It calls for the Scottish Government to reverse its approval of the major service change to healthcare services in Skye, Lochalsh and South West Ross. We have received responses on the petition from the Cabinet Secretary and the Scottish Ambulance Service. The Cabinet Secretary's response sets out information about the decision to improve the service changes and where work has been identified for NHS Highland to take forward. The response states that approval has been granted and that it is now important to move forward and ensure the plans put forward by NHS Highland provide the best possible services for all the people of Skye, Lochalsh and South West Ross. The Scottish Ambulance Service response details a number of measures it has put in place to deliver services within the redesign. The response from the petitioner sets out views about the options appraisal process and why the petitioner considers the decision to have been made on incomplete information. And a detailed critique by Professor Ronald MacDonald is attached to the petitioner's submission. And I wonder if members have any comments or views on what further action we may wish to take within the terms of the action called for in the petition. And I don't know whether it might be worthwhile maybe getting Rhoda and Kate to say something just to help our considerations.
Yeah, I'm happy to say something. I was at the committee when you last considered this petition, and the comments I think I made then still stand, in that I don't think anyone wants a delay to a new hospital in Skye, because you know it's been delayed for far too long. But there are issues about the service that the people in the north of Skye receive and how that's going to be delivered, and I don't see anything in the papers to say whether or not any discussions have been carried out with the people living in the north of Skye about the services that they will receive to give them a degree of comfort. Also, the Scottish Ambulance Service response talks about their emergency response, to be honest, and they talk about increasing the number of staff on the ground, but I'm not sure that is adequate, because I understand quite often in the Scottish Ambulance Service are not just taking people to the hospital on Skye, they're taking people to Inverness, and that can mean an ambulance off island for a long period of time. And I hear anecdotally that sometimes there is very little or no cover on Skye. So I think it would be worth going back to them about that. And certainly the concern about, you know, they've got an ambulance on Rassie, but, you know, four wheels and a vehicle is not much good to anybody because they don't appear to have any staff, but it can be driven by nominated local people, and that is of a concern as well. But there are bigger issues in Rassie that maybe you don't want to get involved in. But it says nothing about patient transport, and I think that is the big issue, because when people are going to the hospital for routine treatments or indeed non-life-threatening treatments, they're not going to phone 999 and get an ambulance out. But what their problem is if they don't drive, elderly people not able to drive in adequate public transport, how do they get to the hospital? And I don't think the Scottish Ambulance Service has addressed that at all. In fact, they haven't really spoken about patient transport in their response.
Okay,
Great. Yep, thank you. I think I'd echo a lot of what Rhoda said. It's wonderful to have the prospect of a new hospital, but in order to get to that point, we need to have the confidence of the population and of the users who are going to be using the new hospital. I think it's also quite important to separate two things here, which is prospect of new services, as well as the location of a physical brick and mortar hospital and where that should be. Professor Ronald MacDonald's paper, his most recent paper, raises three issues which I would at least be interested in a response from, say, from the Cabinet Secretary and from NHS Highland, on population density, on income deprivation in the north end of Skye, and also, as Rhoda's mentioned, Rhoda Grant's mentioned, on travel options. So when the A87 does have a blockage, how are people expected to get from one side of the island to the other? And I think we need some more answers on those things. I think, too, to the ambulance service, I personally wasn't content with the response. I think a lot of it was written in the past tense, so this has already happened, but that doesn't necessarily resonate with what I see on the ground, and there's still a lot of local concern about the inadequacy of the ambulance service. Fantastic paramedics who do a wonderful job on the ground, but probably need some more confidence about the ambulance service on the ground. RASE is obviously included. There are additional issues on RASE to do with not just the redesign, but about the lack of 24/7 care on RASE itself, which is almost a PS in this document. But I personally think it's quite a crucial thing to factor into redesign, because it is a redesign for Lochalsh, Skye, and South West Ross. So I think there are issues that perhaps need more answers.
Okay, I think that has been very helpful from both of you. Thank you for that. I mean, in terms of action, I think the very least we could do is ask the Cabinet Secretary to respond to the critique that's been provided about from Professor MacDonald, but also factoring in the comments that have been made by our colleagues, specifically around the ambulance service, confidence in that, patient transport, which I think is a very significant issue, both in rural and remote areas, but also in urban areas with poor bus services. I'm not quite sure, and you know an awful lot more about this than I do, to what extent the RASE question is encapsulated inside this, or are we opening up something separate and asking for comments in that? So we could maybe get the clerks to just look at that, but what we would be looking at would be response to the critique from Professor MacDonald, and also an addressing of the question around the ambulance services and returning to them, and that be agreed?
Agreed, yes.
Okay, and thank you very much for your attendance. I think we've managed to get there just in time before the powers of the Parliament come after us for sitting too long. Can I just take this opportunity to thank everybody on the committee and the clerks for making my job so easy in this first term of the new Petitions Committee. I genuinely really appreciate that, and I know that three of our members here are new, and Angus has resisted the temptation to tell me exactly what I should be doing as the longest serving member. So I just want to wish you all a very, very happy Christmas, have a good break, and I think we're all looking forward, hopefully, to a peaceful new year. And with that, can I close the meeting?
Thank you.